Let's do some physics. In this video, we're going to handle the problem of the Higgs mechanism in a general orthogonal Yang-Mills theory, and in the process, we'll prove the Goldstone theorem for such a general case. In this problem, we'll be breaking symmetry with a real scalar field, because a complex field isn't necessary to have O(n) symmetry. A complex field would, however, be necessary to make a unitary gauge symmetry possible. Before we head into the problem, I want to clarify what I mean by an orthogonal Yang-Mills theory. Most people define Yang-Mills theory to refer to the minimal vector gauge theory with SUN as its gauge group. One can, however, write similar gauge theories with any Lie group. In this video, I use the term orthogonal Yang-Mills theory to refer to nearly the same definition I just gave, but where SUN is replaced by ON. Such an orthogonal Yang-Mills theory coupled to a real scalar field set to spontaneously break symmetry is given by this Lagrangian, where we select the potential V of phi to be such that it has the following vacuum solution. From this, we can write the standard scalar field reparameterization and the gauge transformation that absorbs the Nambu-Goldstone bosons into the vector fields to become massive. It turns out that for an arbitrary ON group, the number of degrees of freedom that are affected by the transformations in a given subgroup is equal to the number of generators not in that subgroup. The fields set equal to zero in the new scalar vacuum represent the subset of scalar field degrees of freedom that are affected by the symmetry transformation under which the vacuum, and therefore the spontaneously broken Lagrangian, is invariant. Therefore, the number of fields set equal to zero in the new scalar vacuum will always equal the number of spontaneously broken generators. This fact is important because if we can show that the number of vector fields that become massive through the gauge absorption of Nambu-Goldstone bosons is equal to the number of broken generators, then we will have proven the Goldstone theorem for an arbitrary orthogonal Yang-Mills theory. To do that, we need to obtain the spontaneously broken Lagrangian density. In principle, we must therefore follow the standard program of inserting the field reparameterization and then gauge rotating the Nambu-Goldstone bosons into the gauge fields corresponding to the broken generators. As I noted in past videos, this can be done in any order, and the most algebraically convenient order is the reverse. Given gauge invariance, the gauge-transformed Lagrangian density has the same form as what we started with. We can then insert the gauge-transformed field reparameterization. From here, all we need to do is algebraically rearrange the middle term to reveal the vector boson mass terms. The first step is to distribute V plus sigma, and then break up the I index sum. We can then distribute completely and simplify, and then reassemble the I index sum. I break up and then reassemble the sum because I think it makes the algebra clearer. I simply find it easier to get the right answer when I do the algebra like that. At this point, remember that the ON generators are antisymmetric in order to make the group orthogonal. Therefore, the NN component of the generators is actually zero, because all the diagonal components are zero. Therefore, we're left with this. The reason why I waited to bring this up until now is that leaving the math general helps make the isospin index sum manipulations more clear. Inserting this back into the Lagrangian gives us the final expression for the spontaneously broken Lagrangian density. It's much easier to tell what's going on in this Lagrangian if we break it up. Now for the bit we've all been waiting for. The matrix and the vector boson mass term has n minus m non-zero eigenvalues because of the n indices. As a result, we have a theory with m massless vector fields and n minus m massive ones. We've therefore verified that the Higgs mechanism, according to the Goldstone theorem, works for a general orthogonal Yang-Mills theory. The problem of unitary groups in a complex scalar field is similar. I hope you enjoyed this video, or at least found it interesting. If you did, please consider sharing it with a friend, giving it a thumbs up, and subscribing.